Okay, thank you. Can you hear me? Thank you very much. I'm happy to come today and talk to you about changes to the premium pay business model resulting from OTT. As you can imagine, it's something that's in my head every single day. I'd like to say a few words about HBO Europe. HBO Europe, and I'm in particular responsible for the markets where HBO actually has full-blown television operations. So this means linear feeds, on-demand provided to operators, HBO Go we have rolled out, started in Central Europe. And this is a legacy part of the history of the European business. Poland is our largest market, Romania also quite large. 1991 was the first launch into Hungary, and 2012 our most recent launch into the Netherlands. Again, markets where we have full-blown television operations. And let's talk about changes in the business model. So I decided to go back 10 years ago, and for me that's pretty easy because in February of 2015, I will be in my position for 10 years. And so it was really easy for me to go, gosh, what was it like when I started, and then think what it's like today. So the good news is the business model from 10 years for us fits on one page. Okay, it's pretty simple. On the technology side, we just have standard definition playout. On the content side, we have some acquired product, also some fully owned product, put out some linear multiplexes, push it out via satellite, going down to the consumer through cable and satellite operators. With the cable and satellite operators, because we are a B2B business, we're either stipulating a wholesale rate, maybe in some cases we have a revenue share. And for those of you who don't know, HBO is sold in the premium tier of televisions, and it is an advertising-free service. There are no advertisements on this service. It is strictly subscription-driven. Now, 10 years later, the big news on the technology side, it has become incredibly complex. We are rolling, now we broadcast in HD, in some instances down converting to standard definition where operators can't handle the HD. We also provide on-demand content to operators, which we encode in-house and push the files out. And a very expensive investment, which is why it has lots of those green dollar signs behind it, is that we have built our own broadband software for our HBO Go service, and we also happen to run our own content distribution network behind it to make sure that when the consumer wants, because we're premium, when the consumer wants our product, they are able to access it fast, in high quality, with no interruptions. Our software, by the way, is different from the software which is available in the United States. It's been built in Hungary primarily, and we've been able, because it's very good, very language flexible, we provided it out to HBO in Asia, now we're working with HBO Latin America. But it is a whole new world for television companies when you have to simultaneously work on software. And the software changes all the time, new functionalities, new devices. It's very complicated, actually. Content side, I'll talk about in a minute, so I won't go into that too much now. Now we have a whole range of premium services that have happened to us over a 10-year period. We still have multiplexes. We have the on-demand to the operator. We have high definition. We have broadband. Pushing that again out to our business partners, using satellite, using fiber. Satellite costs, thanks to fiber, did get a little bit cheaper. That was very good for us. And then getting down to the consumer level, now we're forced to be able to serve multiple devices, which we can do and do, using our business partners still. Cable, satellite, we do have some ISP deals across Europe for standalone HBO Go. And we are ready now to do mobile high-speed internet, which I think is, again, a great proposition for the consumer. Now, in that changing business model, there have been some amazing challenges over the last 10 years. And one of the biggest ones that has affected us has related to content, in particular to acquired content. So if you look at the top part of this slide, I labeled it 2004. I guess that's sort of what I remember when I walked in the door. We had a really long window on acquired studio content. So it would start in the US, you know, it'd have a theatrical release, it would have a DVD sales window. And by the time it got to our consumer in Europe, everybody knew what it was. We didn't have to market it too much. We still had a pretty robust business. And what's happened now 10 years later, I mean, chaos maybe is a word we can use. Is the windows have shortened. The shortening of windows is something that's very common to talk about in the television world now. People trying to go out date and date, people trying to go out now very carefully, in part because of piracy and because of a very fractured business model, going out very quickly with the product, US theatrical or a day and date release, pushing it through its windows and trying to still get it out internationally while the content still has value. So it's coming to the premium pay window much faster. But by the time it gets to us, actually it's hardly exclusive at all, right? It's already been out there. Gosh, we compete with all the BitTorrents, not to mention Amazon or iTunes or whoever else is out in the markets providing the content. Now, it's nice to have all the nice technology we've built, but if we don't have really fabulous content for it, our business model will in fact fall apart. So, I like to say we knew that all of this was coming, what's on the bottom part of that slide. Of course, we didn't know exactly, but we had a feeling about it. So, what we've done, and I know you all think of HBO as a U.S. programming producer, but I should take a minute and tell you that HBO Latin America, which is a much bigger business than the European business, actually produces loads of original content. HBO Asia also going into original content, and in Europe we also produce locally. And we do believe that the local stories are very important. And one of the things that I thought I could say today that would add value to the forum is basically try and say some things about local content, try in particular to highlight to you something which I really do believe, which is that local content for smaller markets may be at a little bit of a risk in this very robust world. So I decided I would start by putting a slide about feature film production up, which isn't TV production, but feature film production is a good indicator. So if you look here, what you get on this slide is a lot of major markets, a lot of major language groups. I'm sure I'm not telling anybody here anything new if I tell you that small countries are not the biggest producers of video content in the world, right? And I put a little header on the slide, OTT, huge economies of scale for major language content. And I believe that's also true. That content is going to go out everywhere. The language groups are very popular. And then I'd like to, very pertinent to my region, highlight a question that was brought up in a film market book from this year that particularly concerns the countries of Central and Eastern Europe. And it says, is it normal that 10 years after EU enlargement, EU admissions of films originating from new member states constitute an average of 1.2 of all EU admissions, even though those countries represent 19% of the total EU population, right? This is simply a reflection of the fact these countries are post-communist, markets may be a little more fragile, you know, video production is not really where it could be. And basically, when we look at it, we know something, and I bet all of you know this too, and I don't think I would be bringing anything new. Local stories are an incredibly important part of our cultures, right? You may like American films, but if you're Belgian, you might actually like the Belgian stuff better, right? I think that you can find this in the music industry, you certainly find it in the production industry. And one thing we've gone out to do, which the consumer just loves, is to produce more local content inside of the markets that we're in. So we started with documentaries. I want to show you a few reels of things that we produced. In the little promo reels, you'll be able to see what some of the reaction has been to some of this product. On this cover slide here, we have a few product that's in the reel that I'll just highlight to you. So something called The Great Night, that's about night workers in the Czech Republic. Overdose, about a Hungarian racehorse. Stream of Love, about the love lives of mostly people, I would say, between the ages of 70 and 90 up in the Transylvanian mountains of Romania, who are Hungarians. You're the Dragon in Bucharest, about the Chinese population in Bucharest. And Deep Love, about a Polish diver who had a stroke and wanted to go back and dive again. So this is something we produce for our markets. I'll just give you a little feel of what that's like, and you can see what some of the reaction to the production of that content has been.
Thank you.
that a recently produced documentary from Romania called Toto and His Sisters just won the best international film or documentary film at the Zurich Film Festival over the weekend. So a lot of the stuff that we're working on is also going out of market, bringing the stories from those particular countries out. Off from the documentaries, which can be considered kind of niche, but nice, I think, one thing absolutely happens, which is that if we produce well locally, we beat any American product or foreign product that you can put on our channels. This particular content that's here is a format. It was originally an Israeli format called Shall We Kiss. We brought it in. We started with it in Hungary. We adapt the scripts. We produce it locally. Tarsas Jatek in Hungary beats Game of Thrones. Does anyone know Game of Thrones, the HBO product? It beats Game of Thrones, right? Also, we produce it in Romania, second to Game of Thrones, right? And the Czech one is just coming out this fall. So again, I'll just show you a reel, get a feeling for what that's like. It shows off the local cities that we're in. This is also something very important to us.
Whatever I feel for you, you only seem to care about you. Is there any chance you could see me too? I love you. Where the light shivers offshore through the tides of oceans, we are shining in the rising sun.
Nagyon vonzónak találok.
As we are floating in the blue, I am softly watching you. But boy, your eyes betray what burns inside you. Whatever I feel for you,
szüksége van rám.
Tényleg beteg vagy.
Is there any chance you could see me too? 'Cause I love you. After all, I drifted ashore through the streams of oceans. But now the sound of love is out of tune. Whatever I feel for you, you only seem to care about you. Is there any chance you could see me too? 'Cause I love you. Is there anything I could do just to get some attention from you in the ways of love that left a trace of you? Where are you?
Shall We Kiss is basically a very adult format. It's essentially about adults treating each other poorly in relationships, which seems to be something that we're very good at. And true to premium television, you know, it's a little sexy. It's not for the general consumption audience, but premium television is a particular space and it does need a particular product. And it's actually with tremendous pleasure that I bring to you a product that reflects what we're really all about at the end of the day and something we strive to do in our markets, although I can tell you that it's incredibly difficult. We're very passionate about doing it. Burning Bush is a story of, it's from the Czech Republic. It's a story of the self-immolation of Jan Palach and the lawsuit that followed afterwards. It's in 1969 when the Russians came in to occupy the Czech Republic. It's a story of his mother and a lawyer trying to clear his name in front of the Soviet state. Now, of course, this was devastating. They ended up losing everything. The good part of the story at the end, obviously, is that the young female lawyer, Dagmar Bereshiva, eventually became Václav Havel's first minister of justice. This is a Czech product. It's been all around the world. It has gone to multiple festivals. It received a standing ovation at the Toronto Film Festival. And it's directed by Oscar-nominated Agnieszka Holland, who happened to have gone to film school in the Czech Republic and was happy to come and direct for us, which for us was a fabulous thing. And I'll just show you, this is sort of a reel that shows you a little bit about the film, also shows you a little bit about how it was received and the awards that it's been able to win.
Naše skupina se skládá z dobrovolníků, kteří jsou odhodláni se dát pro naši věc upálit.
obětoval svůj život pro svou zemi, pro pravdu a svobodu.
Proč to neřeknete rovnou?
Co jako?
No, že máte strach.
Národ čeká na pravdu.
Věřím, že oběť mého syna nebude nikdy zapomenuta.
Now this is obviously very moving product. It's produced obviously, you know, our the things I've shown you are produced in very small markets. It does rather beg the question of who's going to go into these kinds of products if it's not going to be in the premium pay space. So I put some OTT thoughts down at the end. Which I like you all to think about. The economies of scale which are being created with OTT need to be carefully considered. Global and local business models applied in market need to be compared on a holistic basis. In a world dominated by globally targeted OTT players, English language content is likely to dominate. Other major content will be a common feature. Minor language content may be at risk. In a highly competitive OTT world, all players will experience higher costs and fractured revenue lines. Especially in smaller, frailer markets, local content may be uneconomical to produce, no matter how much loved by the consumer. And finally, at the end of the day, the question might not be how to provide free or discounted content to facilitate the rollout of technical services. The real question may be what is done to stimulate and preserve high-quality market-driven local video culture, entertaining viewers in their own language, and telling European stories in a way that is rich and compelling. And those are my thoughts for you. Thank you very much.
I invite Giuseppe Di Martino from Daily Motion, Mr. Sang Kim from Samsung, and Mr. Marcus Reini from Vodafone. Then, I don't know about you, but I was a bit dreaming, and I saw that on one of your first slides that I could see those programs on my tablet and my phone, and also my broadband connection. Let's see in one moment. Just before we start a flow of questions, I would like to tell you a short story tale. The story tale is that I heard from the beginning that OTTs of such discussion media was, you know, two worlds living beside each other. Then after a few moments, they start to work together. Sometimes on the easiest way, sometimes it was more difficult. And the question is, how we'll finish the story? And then if we look on the telecom market, we see that, and we saw that earlier in the morning, that bundles are becoming reality. We see that triple play and quadruple play are becoming reality everywhere. And if you don't have all components of those bundles, it might be an issue. I heard also that this morning that we talk about a bazaar in Europe, and I'm questioning what does it mean, and maybe you will have a view on that. We believe as a consumer today, I would like to have the choice, any device, any time, any place. I would like to show those nice movies. I would like to play with friends. I would like to exchange a lot of contacts with everybody. We are, I believe, in the middle of a journey, and then I would like to ask each of you, what does it mean, OTT, from your point of view? Who you are, and what do you believe are the challenges we have to answer and to take to make sure that in the future, I, as a consumer, will be able to get benefits of all those nice movies and content. Then Giuseppe from Dailymotion, can you share with us your view?
Should I push something? That's okay. Jacques, thank you for the invitation. I'm a bit nervous to be among you this afternoon as a service, an internet service. I don't have the habit to meet, discuss with regulators. As you know, on the web, there are no limited resources. It's very easy to launch a service. We don't need any license. We don't need any authorization. And there are no counterparts, any duties that we should have on our daily tasks. That said, what is Dailymotion? Dailymotion is a video content distribution platform. First of all, we are a tool, a technical tool, a video player. And we launched the service in order to help the content creators to liaise, to have a direct contact with the public and with the advertisers. So that's really our goal, to help these different worlds to work together. The service is, of course, free for the users. We sell ads, advertising campaigns around the video uploaded by our thousands of partners. And then we share with the content creators the revenues we got through the advertising. A few figures about Dailymotion. Maybe you don't know our platform. We are born in Europe. We feel not being European. Also, we are born in Paris and then London. We feel that, first of all, we are digital. We deliver a worldwide service. And we want to be seen as another service given to the world, the economic world I was mentioning before. A couple of figures, we have something like 300 million unique viewers each month, one third of them in Europe. Our first market should be the United States and the South American countries. We have something like 50,000 content creators as partners, from Warner Music to The Guardian to I don't know, Le Figaro in France, or all the big names you can imagine. And we try to provide a new kind, sorry to insist, a new kind of relationship. It's free, there is no subscription. It's available on all devices, from tablets to mobile, and of course, on computers. And we feel that we are at the beginning of the history. Video is booming, as you know. Digital advertising is booming. And what we hope is that all together we are going to create always new links in order to help the consumer, Jack, for instance, to get the best service available and the best service whenever the consumer needs it. Thank you, Jack.
Thank you. Then I will come back to you. Then Linda was already saying and showing a business model. It's rather complex. Mr. Kim, from a Samsung perspective, how do you see the OTTs? What is OTTs and how is it affecting your activities? And of course, in your portfolio, you have smart TVs and not only phones. And I think it will be interesting to have a 360 degree about how is it affecting the portfolio in general.
First of all, this is a great pleasure to be invited to this conference. And
I'm very happy to be part of this conference on behalf of Samsung. And I want to tell you that Samsung is in very unique position in current IT in industry, in the sense that we have various kinds of product portfolio, from the mobile phones to TV, smart TV, and consumer electronics, home appliances, and up to the semiconductors. So we cooperate with many players in the market, from telecom operators, and of course the content providers for smart TV. And also we cooperate with our competitors, because without our semiconductor chip, the memory chip, and the microprocessor, they cannot make the best product. So we understand the needs and the requirement for the marketplace in IT industry. And they have all different interests. So it is very difficult to harmonize and find just one solution for the challenges we are facing now. But we, for this unique position in the market, we can understand the every needs from the various players. So as for the OTT, it is a kind of new arrival to on the earth, which it did not exist before. I think we need to accept and admit the new change and make it contribute to the benefit for the every player in the market. But of course there are many challenges and difficulties to find to the best way to regulate and control the new technologies on, we found. So I think we need to find the best solution between the legacy players and new players. There must be a gap, because the current regulation is to control what already exists. We cannot make a law or regulation which does not exist. So there's a time gap when new technology arrives in, to our world, and to make a law to regulate that new technology, there must be a gap, time gap. But the important thing is to reduce that gap as soon as possible. To do so, we need to cooperate among the major players in the market, which are not only the regulators, but also the content providers and device manufacturers and telecom operators. We need to think about how to regulate this matter, not for the interest of themselves, but for the interest of the whole market and for the consumers. So that is my basic thought about that.
Marcus, then we have the handset, we have a lot of content available. Then can you bring the dots together? How is it affecting your business model, OTT? Is it really an issue?
Jack, first again, thanks for inviting me to come here. And you know, you've taken sort of the prerogative as the chair of speaking from a consumer's perspective. And I would retaliate with actually responding first from a consumer perspective as well, because that's what it's really about. And if I look at, you know, first handset market and also the content market and the OTT market overall, OTT services are something fantastic and something very attractive. They are very innovative and very new. I'm an excessive user of OTT services myself. And the reason why this is attractive is it's a combination of two things. It's a combination of innovation, and it's a combination of very creative business models, which are new to the industry. You have two-sided markets, for example, in the OTT industry, where the advertisers pay or subsidize the services that are provided to the consumers. you have business models which, you know, are about gaining scale and not necessarily of gaining revenue or profits in the first place. You also have business models that monetize data, and that's something very attractive as well, as long as it's done responsibly. So we see enormous consumer benefits for me as a consumer. We see also knock-on effects to other industries, like my industry, the telecommunications industry, because in order to compete with OTT players, you know, we are forced to come up with new packages. We come up with tiered packages where we don't sell voice and SMS and data. We sell data, and we sell tiered data, and then voice and SMS is included. This is something that is very attractive for me as a customer. So I think, from the first point, something very, very positive. And then let's talk about the operator's perspective. It's not too different. You know, OTT services are something very, very positive. They're attractive. They are what our customers want. They make my product sticky. They complement, in many instances, what I don't have. And if you look at Vodafone, and you ask us not to plug our own companies, but just to give an example here, the way we market 4G, for example, in the UK, is not by selling 4G. We sell Spotify, Netflix, Sky bundled in with higher data package allowances. So, you know, we manage and we create demand for our services by the demand that our customers have for OTT services. So something very, very positive. And, you know, everything is perfect. Maybe not. You know, I think there are issues, and there are issues not so much from the perspective and only the perspective of an investor in the future digital infrastructure of Europe. It's also there are concerns for a consumer and a citizen, a European citizen. And there are many, but I want to concentrate on two of them. And the first one is what I would call the unequal treatment. And this is not the clever way to sort of avoid the level playing field debate, but I personally don't like the word level playing field very much, because it has a bit of an sort of an introspective notion. And it has this term, so same service, same rules, which is what the operators think. I think the battle cry should be same service, same protection. I, as a customer, want to have the same protection, regardless if it is a telecom service, whether if it's an OTT service or not. And it's not only, it is about the rules, but it is not only about the rules. I think the much bigger impact than not having the same rules is that the enforcement is very different. I struggle as a consumer, if something goes wrong, to have my rights enforced, because I don't know necessarily where this OTT sits, and it's the nature of the OTT. So I think this is an issue from a consumer perspective, not so much only from an operator's perspective. And the second point is, I can port my telecoms life. I can port my service, I can port my telephone number. And Carlos, you have coined this phrase, is why can't I port my digital life as a consumer? Why can I not take my applications with me? Why can I not take my contacts with me? So there seems to be a very strong imbalance between the industries. And as a consumer, I should be concerned about this, that there is not equal treatment of my interests. The other area which concerns me much, much more, again, as a consumer, as a citizen, and also as an investor, is sort of this slow monopolization of the OTT market, the concentration. We have really passed the stage of this creative entry and creative destruction. We see digital fortresses emerging in the OTT market. And I just, you know, give you some numbers, and you probably know them, but just let's look at the OS market, and I think you probably very aware of this as well, is that there are two companies that have 94.6% of the OS market, operating system market. So that's Apple and that's Android. And out of that, Android has 87.4%. So we see a concentration which is really, really unique in the telecoms market. Amazon has 60% of the cloud market. We have Google. I don't have to say much about the dominance of Google. My CEO asked last week at the Ethno conference, he said, who of you would invest in the next search engine? You know, I want to extend that question to you. Who would invest? You know, is it really such a dynamic and vibrant market? And let's ask the question, who would invest in the next social media messaging service? And this is a very topical question, because the European Commission, as we've heard before, think there will be plenty. Yeah, that's, you know, MySpace went out of business a couple of years ago. But I think that we have reached a turning point here. And again, a couple of numbers. Instagram, Facebook, and WhatsApp have together around 2 billion customers. the total smartphone market is around 2 billion customers. Who can invest in a new service where I compete with an address book of 2 billion customers? So I think, you know, the concentration has really reached a point where we can't really use the argument of this creative destruction and dynamic entry into the market. We are creating digital fortresses. And the telecoms industry is not, you know, new to digital fortresses. And there's one example, which is the fixed market. I think we still haven't cracked competition in the fixed market. I still think that we don't have sustainable competition. And, you know, people will say we have retail market shares of below 50% of incumbent operators. But if you look at the profit market share, which is really the measure of competition, we still see many markets with incumbents having north of 85%, sometimes even north of 100% of the market share. And this is not the point talking about fixed, but what I want to say here is, let's be wary of digital fortresses. Let's be wary, because if we have them, it is extremely difficult to get out of them. And let me just finish with two requests, and that's sort of is amplifying what Sang-Woo said. Is, I think we need to act very quickly. We need to act very quickly to counter concentration and monopolization in the market. We need to address dominance, and we need to address the abuse of dominance in all markets, but specifically the OTT market. And secondly, we do need net neutrality legislation. So I repeat that. We do need net neutrality legislation. And we need it in Europe, and apply it in a harmonized way. We need it applicable to everybody in the internet value chain, everybody who has the potential to distort the internet market. And we have to move towards digital neutrality and away from purely having network neutrality. And my last point, if I find it, is, absolutely the most important one is that net neutrality has to be done around three core principles, and principles alone. And these principles, they need to prevent non-discrimination, they have to create transparency, and they have to ensure some form of best net effort internet. And if we manage these two things, I think we create a level playing field or equal treatment for all of our customers.
One, okay. Thank you, Marcus. I'm so sorry. It was so complex. Maybe all of them, they understood. As a consumer, I buy a package. I have SMS, voice, I understand. I have data. I want to see the content. And it seems to be so complex. And maybe, Linda, can you explain me what he was telling me? Because you want to offer your content. He wants to convey to me. Then I don't see the issue. It should be quite easy. And hopefully, of course, Mr. Kim, I can use your handset to do it. Then normally we should agree this afternoon that it should be an easy discussion. I don't understand all the complex subject, but it seems the people here, yes. Can you tell me, or Giuseppe, how we can fix that? Because you talk about dominance, you talk about competition and so on. You know, I want to see the nice movie. Then, Linda, how can we... What are the issues from your perspective?
I need to push that again. Can you hear me? Yeah. Well, you know, from our point of view, I think providing in any, you know, into any kind of business model, first for us, part of the question is it a business, right? Is it a long-term business? Is it a short-term business? I think when you get... into a different kind of atmosphere, and we don't go directly OTT, the HBO standalone that we have now in our market is bundled together with a television package provided across the internet. So that's what we've done so far in the markets where I'm there. There's a lot of questions for us if you move outside of that model, right? We are now in a business-to-business relationship where somebody is servicing the customer, right? So there's a lot of questions there. You're a consumer, right? If you have a problem, who are you calling? Right, you're going to call me, HBO? I don't have a customer service function. You know, you're going to call your telco provider?
Okay, tell me.
Maybe that's a little different. Well, that has to get figured out, right? And then you have software application people, and you have devices, and it's also absolutely fascinating when you start going into the newer markets, because they come to us, and they say, well, we would like a part of your revenue stream. And it's like, okay, I totally understand that. But there's only so many pieces in the food chain where people can eat. guess. At a certain point, something actually has to be left for the people who have made the content, and it has to be enough to continue the whole content provision and the standards that we're used to on the quality side. So even though the consumer, I think, often wants, I think the flip side of those questions are, from that lovely content all the way down to the consumer, you know, how many fish were biting at the worm, and is there anything left on the hook? And that's something that I think, because these models are very new, is still being worked out, right? What is the right way to do these kinds of service provisions where the consumer gets service and the content gets out there and it's still viable for the content makers? So I would see that whole food chain question as part of the question.
Okay, thank you. Giuseppe, because I understood something we are listening carefully from someone when it's free, you know? As a consumer, I'm used to pay free. I like it. Then with the discussion we had there, then is it, you know, meaning something? Or yeah, you say, can you add something?
The fact to be free doesn't mean that you are available. As Marcus highlighted before, there are some American digital fortresses on the web, and a way maybe to block them, block their development, or to give a chance to other actors, and sorry to use these words that for a regulator it means a lot, but we could imagine a kind of must carry or a must offer from some operators in order to make the services available for everybody and not only the usual suspect. I guess that Vodafone is pre-uploading YouTube on its service, but I'm sure that Dailymotion is not available.
And I hear two words I understand. Thank you very much for that. Must offer. I like offers. And carry, I understand too. Then, you know, you were talking about, you know, players' dominance and so on. And, you know, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to have those programs. And when I talked to one, he said, you know, they don't want to offer me. And when I talked to the other one, they don't want to carry me. Then I'm a bit lost, because in between, sometimes I hear that my handset will not be open to upload those applications because I don't know which reason, because I purchased my handset and now I purchase few of them to make sure that I can get everything I want. But what's the story? Is it a must offer discussion, a must carry discussion? Do we have some bottlenecks on the equipment manufacturer side? May I have your views, Mr. Kim?
Yes. Well, as a consumer myself, I'm also a consumer, and sometimes, sometimes I want some application which is only available on our competitor, Apple. But why is that? I agree with you. I feel that need. But this is a very difficult question. First of all, it is not about the device manufacturer. We can ready to produce every product to available to every OS. But if I add something, I think this is like a traffic direction in London and Brussels. I'm based in Brussels. I came to Brussels 9 months ago, and I travel during the weekend with my driving car to Paris and Dusseldorf, Ghent, Antwerp. But I wish to go to London driving my car, but I'm scared because I have to drive the wrong direction. So I wish every country has the same rule about the direction of the car. Is it fantastic? Isn't it fantastic? But the reality is not the case. And I don't think it is the best example for to explaining the difference between Android and the iOS. But everybody knows that if we have the same platform, it will be beneficial to everybody. But reality is, can you make it? British, UK, give up the traffic rule, or Australia, New Zealand, Hong Kong. So it's kind of reality. And for the technology world, there is a very famous example. It's about the standard battle, standard war, about the videotape format. The Sony invented the so-called Betamax format for the first time in the world. And it was, I was really surprised to see we can record the TV program at home, and later I can see it. It was a kind of revolution at that time. But after that, JVC invented another format. And from the purely technological point of view, Betamax, which was invented by Sony, was superior than to the VHS, which was invented later. But who was the winner? The Betamax disappeared from years. So it is very difficult to ask our regulators to make a law which unified and decide one of those two dominant OS. So as a device manufacturer, we really wish some very strong regulator make a decision on this one or that one. Then we can reduce our cost to produce. But currently, we are ready to produce every product which is available to every consumers.
Marcus, then, if I understand, I will be able to upload potentially everything I want. I can see everything on the handset. Then, when you said that is sort of new dominance and some issues and so on, then how do you see we have to fix it? I just heard something. I understand must carry, must offer. Do we have to call? I heard something like, you know, regulators or something like that. I don't know what do they do, but you know, regulators to take some actions on that. Do we have to intervene? Maybe not. You know, it's a world free. What's your views?
I think the simple answer is, if there is abuse of the market, if there's dominance and abuse of the market, then a regulator or a competition authority has to intervene. And I just, you know, a bit of a notion of, I think you're trying to create sort of an antagonistic relationship here, which I understand why, but there isn't actually, as far as I know, in Europe a problem with getting content to our customers. And as far as I know, we do not block Dailymotion. We do not block any legal content in Europe. And I think what we're talking about here is something that we have imported from a different region, from the US, where there is a highly concentrated market, where Comcast, for example, has a 61% monopoly share, in that sense, it's the only cable operator in areas. We don't have that in Europe. If I would block content, my customers would leave me. And this is very, very different to the home of the net neutrality debate. So please tell me where there is a problem of not receiving legal content on our networks, on the Vodafone network, on the Telefonica network, on any other network. I think it doesn't exist. So let's sort the one side of the market out, you know. But if there is sort of a foreclosure of that market, and I would be able, without any repercussions, to discriminate, competition law, regulation has to come in. Let's look on the other side of the market. If there is abuse, you have to really deal with monopolies and fortresses. And to a consumer, you know, to translate this, what does it mean? Choice is good, and not having choice is bad. And that's the reason why, from a consumer perspective, you should be very, very concerned about these emerging bottlenecks and monopolies.
I try again to bring that together, and then I understand that it's quite complex. Let me try as a consumer to try to fix something. You said, Linda, earlier that who I have to call and so on. I understand that everyone is positive. It's good day today, isn't it? Then, you know, when I purchase products, you know, I remember my father was paying three invoices and so on. No, I purchase a bundle, it's quite easy. You ask me who I have to pay, who the contract and so on. I heard from the European Commission about companies purchasing others, and they call that verticalization, and means that networks buying content, buying, I don't know, you know, the whole chain is integrating. Is it the direction? What do we have to think about it? From a consumer perspective, having one single invoice, it's good. But I'm just having maybe some concerns about what will be the impact on the offering and the price. Linda, do you have an idea about it?
Well, I mean, clearly there are, and certainly in our markets as well, there are loads of operators who have decided to augment their offerings with content, and that's very normal. And I think, you know, on a competitive basis, obviously we're out there to do something that's unique and drive us forward, also very important. Part of what I showed on the slide with the studio windows collapsing and being fragmented at the end when we would finally get any kind of acquired product is also indicative of this, right? You can find the same content in many, many places. I'm not sure that the provision of content by any operator causes concern. In some instances, it could be good. If somebody's good at providing that system, or if they buy a company, it can be good, provided that they are then making sure their system is not discriminating against any competitor to the company that they've acquired. I think in my point of view, when the playing field becomes very distorted, though, can be if you, Jack the consumer, are allowed to rummage around on the internet, and because you're frustrated with your content offering, you're allowed to go to your BitTorrent or pirate site or a peer-to-peer sharing site and start to dig up content from there because that seems to work for you, you know, it's open to you. So I think part of the question for us is, you know, what happens with that?
Do you have a comment around that?
When before we talk about net neutrality, we said that it has been said that the lack of discrimination and the transparency were key, but of course the information of the consumer is one of the crucial point. And as a user, because I'm a user, as a consumer as well, I want to get the truth. I want to know exactly who is paid for the service I'm getting, and what and why I should pay for a service. And this level of information today maybe not given as we could wait. And sorry to answer to Marcus, of course, the emotion is not blocked on Vodafone. My point was about the pre-upload. You know, when the manufacturers, when the telcos choose on behalf of their clients some services to be pushed, most of the time, these services are the most known, the most successful. And my point was to say that today, Dailymotion is the 40th site in the world in terms of audience. But the 39 sites before Dailymotion are or Chinese or American. Maybe we should have a common reflection on how to change this.
Thank you. I think that I will ask the audience to interact with you about that. But just to finish the verticalization issue, I think that some colleagues of you, Mr. Kim, integrated much more. I think from, and there are some movement in the US, I believe, with Time Warner. There was Sony integrating Columbia Tourstar. Do you have plans to do the same, or do you think that it's fine like that? Do you plan to integrate? Do you think that verticalization is good?
We don't have any business related to contents. So we once tried to do content business, but in the current situation, current industry, each player has its own strengths. The manufacturer has strengthening their position in the market, and it is also the case with the content providers. So I think it has pros and cons. One is for they became too dominant, Marcus said. But the other one is the market chose who will survive. The consumer will choose. So as a device manufacturer, we'll concentrate on developing new technologies, which enable the content providers and content makers and telecom operators do their business better for a better society. And I think it is very important because without technology like a fast processor, Linda, I'm sorry, but you cannot provide your beautiful movie to the consumers. And the high definition display, it makes available those health equipment, the electronic and remote health care is possible only because our manufacturer, the device manufacturer, developed new technologies. So even though we are not doing content business, but we are also very proud to be a part of that ecosystem.
I think that I heard that Google, it was one of the one we mentioned earlier, I believe, they are going down or going up. I don't know how do we say the model, who is up and down. It's still unclear for me as a consumer who is up and down. But anyway, they are providing high-speed services in the US. Then don't you think that Vodafone should enter into the media content business and to... No?
Where they're going down, I think they're going up, and rightly so. They have, you know, a very successful company. They have 1% of the fast broadband market share in the US. I would not overstate that necessarily. I think it would be very good if Google would invest in infrastructure, not just in the US but also in Europe. I think that would be a proper level playing field to compete with each other. I need, this should not become sort of a ping pong match between Giuseppe and me, but I think you really made a very important point here about sort of the pre-installation of apps. I'm just sort of open question, who do you think has a lot of influence over which apps are installed on which operating system? Is it a fragmented operator market or is it a very, very concentrated OS market? You know, I leave that with you, the thought. And then you will see that my concern about concentration is very true and permeates all levels of the telecoms market, not the operator market necessarily. So I think it's still a question of dominance in the market, dominance between the OTTs and the fragmented and competitive infrastructure market.
To understand, then you know, I understand that you want to help me, all of you. I'm happy. Then I turn now to the room and say, I understood that you are the people who are able to help me. Then please raise your question to the panel. If you doesn't mind, 20 before 4, I would like to have a solution. Thank you.
My question, Richard Hooper, is to Linda. I thought your keynote speech after lunch was the perfect after-lunch speech, kept us all hugely awake, and that's marvellous. In 2004, you would have been called a broadcaster. It must be pretty ghastly now being called an OTT player, but that's not my question. My question is that I think a lot of us in this room understand how you get your content to me as a consumer via cable and via satellite. Could you just take us through an example of how you get your content through to me sitting there on the internet? Just
okay.
Who do you do deals with? Who yep. pays who? How complicated is it?
Right.
Because it relates also to the Marcus's.
Yes. I try and explain sort of two things again. So We have an HBO Go, it's actually very complicated. We have an HBO Go broadband product that we've built ourselves. It's very lovely. It has as much product from the HBO library as we can possibly put on it. It has all of our currently available films and productions on it, and it's really quite nice, very flexible in language. You can watch in your own language. You can swap and go have titles or dubbing if that's what you want to do. We have not, in my markets, offered that direct to the consumer yet. And I'm not going to say that we're not going to do it. We have some markets with very low pay television penetration, and in those markets, internet growth is far outpacing pay TV growth. So for us not to go and chase something on the internet might be a little silly. So what we knew now is we go to an ISP. For example, our very first deal was a company called Netia in Poland. So we went to Netia, and we were having a discussion with them about how to put this into their television bundle. And we needed it to work because we're just not equipped for it, right? We needed it to work very similar to the way our current deals with cable and satellite work, which is that I don't have a call center, right? I don't have a way to service the consumer. I don't have an invoicing system for them. I mean, okay, maybe in our back pocket we can build it quick if we need it, but... So what we needed was an arrangement where we took our broadband package, we put it into the overall set of broadband television programming that was being offered to the Netia consumer at the end, and then the consumer ends up with something, I think, that's not unlike what they would get from television, where they've subscribed to an internet package instead of subscribing to cable or satellite. And then what they're getting is they're getting a bundle of broadband-provided television services. Now, we're restricted in what we can offer from some of the acquired programming deals that we have. So we have a streamed channel on there, but to be blunt, in the broadband world, people don't watch very much streamed content from HBO. They go looking through the on-demand, so the on-demand is in the front. The stream channel is actually in the back. And that has worked quite well for us. And interestingly enough, on the broadband systems, because HBO Go is such a nice product, it actually gets more usage than it gets on cable and satellite services, in part because operators are not jamming 120 channels of streamed television through their internet service providers, right? They've slimmed down the offer. They don't want to stream that much. People who subscribe to high-speed internet tend to be very highly coincident with our target audience, so it's actually a very nice place for us to be. But the consumer has to be serviced the same way. The consumer needs to pick up the telephone and be able to contact someone if they have a problem that is not inside of my building, because I have not been a direct consumer business. If we were going to go OTT, direct to consumer, then I need to make sure, in all instances, again, we're a premium television service. You know, I can't let the standard go down. So it means if you have a problem, you need to be able to call somewhere. You have a technical issue, you need to be able to contact someone to help you fix it. And we do get emails sometimes about HBO Go that our operators haven't handled. And I chuckle a little bit when on Friday I email the guy who builds Go, and we answer some guy in the Czech Republic about how to delete some older version of the software from his mobile device. I think it's quite nice. But so we need to be able to service the consumer. We need to be able to invoice them. And we would need to be able to market completely differently. Now at HBO, the marketing that we do tends to revolve around our original productions, right? Pushing the value of the content down to the consumer to make sure that they're aware of that. Our business partners in cable and satellite do that a little bit with us. But if we're free from that, we're doing it ourselves, then we're in this we're in this funny acquisition mode where we're acquiring consumers constantly by marketing. So we have to constantly market to them, you know, the entire service, what's the price point, what's on it. It's a different kind of communication, and it's not one that we have traditionally done. And I would not say we won't do it in the future, maybe we will, but at this point, you know, the business model looks a little different from that. And that's a big step for us to take, in particular, because we would not want to let the consumer down. We really don't want to let the consumer down if we were to go direct to consumer. I don't want somebody to email me and get an answer 3 days later about how to fix something on their system, or why some show didn't work, or why the subtitles didn't work.
On that last point, I don't know what the model is, but I know that my daughter doesn't think about resolving consumer issues the way I think about it. She Googles the problem and solves it with other users. And if it can't be resolved that way, or with the provider, there are options. So I think it's a completely new world in which we are operating, and the expectations about how we are going to service consumers or respond to consumers might be a bit different. Innovation is now moving from consumers to enterprise. It's not a linear relationship, and I think enterprises will have to think about how they can be more inclusive in problem solving and in customer relations, because customer relations now very much involve customers relating to customers, not just customers to enterprise. But there is something else I want to understand. When I hear about HBO Europe, I have a notion of a market. HBO Latin America, I have a notion of a market. What is the market for OTTs?
Yeah, from the Mexican regulator. You know, I heard something very interesting about search engines that was mentioned before. And, you know, when you're a telecom regulator, you have a lot of carriers coming to you in your country or abroad telling you that operating systems are a problem and that search engines are a problem. Sometimes the over-the-top players say that carriers are sitting on data that is very valuable and that they don't exploit, and that the data that they have to guess is data that carriers possess. And then this makes me wonder, why don't you make your own operating system, and why don't you make your own search engine? This is something that puzzles me, because I hear complaints about search engines and operating systems, but I don't see any initiatives from carriers trying to build their own operating systems or their own search engine. Thank you.
Marcus, I will give you the floor to start with.
Yeah, can I give you a very candid answer? We tried and we failed. And I think this is a problem that we probably realized too late in which direction the market is going. But the problem is that if we would start today, we would fail again. But if anybody else would start again today, they would fail as well. Because the point is network economies. And we have reached a status, and it's not just OS systems, and it's not just search engines, it's a number of very strong and popular OTT services, where you cannot reach the economies of scale anymore, regardless of who you are, if we were slow or fast, to compete effectively with these players. And I just give you an example with Facebook. You know, Facebook is massive now, it's 2 billion customers. But what happened with the WhatsApp acquisition is not just that they increased the scale, they took out the only possible challenger there is in the market, which is the second largest player in the social media market. So you see that network effects seem to be something extremely important for these players, because that's why they hoover up competition that could actually knock them off this position. And with all due respect to our capabilities and abilities, we would not be the ones who could now enter the market and reverse these dynamics. It is too late. And therefore, we need very vigilant competition authorities to take care of this.
I think we had the second questions. Who would like to take it? No, what you said, they didn't understand. I think you have to raise the question again.
The answer?
Yes.
Okay.
Then I'm happy the regulator understood.
That's an answer, and there's enormous potential for more OTT services, and that's a good thing. I'm not sure if that is answering the question, but there's a lot of potential for OTTs.
question for Mark, I guess, then. So are you saying the barriers to entry are higher in the for a Facebook or Google than in the mobile market? And I think I would also like to hear more about what you meant by digital neutrality. How do you think, how would that be implemented, actually? Thank you.
Yes, I think is the answer to the first one. I mean, we see many, many entrants into the telecoms markets. Yeah, I mean, just take us, for example. We are entering the fixed market. We're building new infrastructure in many countries. So that's possible. Building the new Google, it's not possible. So I think, you know, we are so obsessed, and I'm paraphrasing this from somebody else who said this, but we are so obsessed with operators that have, you know, 20, 30% market share, which are the telecoms operators, and just completely ignore the ones that have 80, 90 and more percent market share. Yes, and if you have such high market shares, you have economies of scale which are just impossible to reach by somebody else. Could you just remind me of the second one? Yes, digital neutrality, yeah. Look, take net neutrality, for example. Yeah. So I don't want to go into too much detail, but the first version, the last version of the European Parliament on net neutrality, pretty much, again, I paraphrase, said, you operators, you cannot manage your networks and you cannot offer any quality services on top of our network. Yeah? So that's fine. Then I go to Google. You know, Google is optimizing its network, is using CDNs or CDN providers. They use data centers close to the customer. They clearly optimize their traffic. Why doesn't that apply to them? Why does it just apply to us? So this is sort of the, you know, same service, same rule direction. So I think there is a clear disparity between the application of these rules. And there are plenty of other examples. I mean, I've given some of them by saying, how can it be that the same rules cannot be enforced across, you know, the markets as we have it right now? So there are a number of areas where we don't have parity in the treatment of the infrastructure, which is actually quite competitive, versus the service providers, which are very monopolistic, and none of these rules apply to them. So I think that's what digital neutrality means to me.
Works. My name is Vanilla Coyne. I'm a lawyer with Bird and Bird. It seems like a part of the discussion is dancing around the question of customer or consumer ownership. At least that's the impression that I get. Marcus, you made one comment which I found very interesting, is why can I not port my digital self? The question I would pose back to the panel is, why do I have to, as long as there's a multiple number of digital selves or identities that I could have, that I could use without problem? I can have an Apple ID, I can have an Google Android ID if I like to, I can be with whichever, I can be with Netflix, the HBO offers, everything more or less seems to be possible as long as there is a platform, or as there are enough platforms available for me to make use of those identities. And should it then not be a question of looking at platforms that make available all these different identities, selves, or content offers that are there? And will that not, that would be the second part of the question, lead to a situation where television in itself, that now really becomes internet capable, will be the device next to tablets and the mobile devices that are being carried around that will decide on how the internet is going to be used?
Yes, please.
So there's a lot in your question. Yeah, there are three parts, as I can understand. Is the control of the customer, which is a very ugly word, but, you know, nonetheless. And it's the sort of this portability and also then the future of the... Let me talk about the control. I think it should not be called control. I think there is a value of me, for example, as Vodafone, seeing what's happening on my network, because I want to optimize for my customers. I want to optimize, for example, to know that you use a handheld screen and not a tablet or a mobile phone, because it makes a difference on how I deliver content to you. So there is a need to know what's going on. That's what I would rather call it than ownership. But this is a threat, by the way. On the portability, again, I would split here. Why can't I take my app from Apple to Android? I can't do that today. You know why? And this is, that bothers me. That really bothers me. You know, I've paid for that. I have made a purchase. We have a digital world. It is not going from Calais to Dover, and then I have for £5,000 get my steering wheel turned on the other side. We're in a digital world. It should be very, very easy to get that done. This is, you know, the abuse to some extent of a very dominant position. I'm always coming back to that theme, you know. And I do think I cannot port my address book to another operator. You say that's fine because I can have many digital identities. But if I have one digital identity, which is the one identity, and if I break out of that, and if it would be too easy for me to port to that one, I would create more competition, for example, and if that is blocked for me, I think there's a problem with this, because interoperability is actually a tool to break down these digital fortresses. So I think there is an issue if there is dominance. There's no issue if I can really choose, pick and choose between sort of equally sized services in the market. And the question about the Samsung TV, I have one. It's fantastic, but I believe as well that's the future. An internet TV. No.
Can you maybe come back on the question and see your views, if you share or you don't share?
Definitely, smart TV will be the next platform for that communication and content provide. But also, we still have many challenges to solve. Including regulations, and currently it is not attract so much attention as smartphone or mobile devices, tablet, but it will definitely in the future, and we would welcome the competition. There will be, if there is a lot of platforms, it is okay for me. And it is also will be good for the market and for the consumers. So the being a dominant, we need to think about how they became dominant in the market. We have the competition law and regulation about the marketing and the way of business. And if you did not do anything illegal, and as the result of your performance, your business, you became dominant, it is okay. I think it is okay. But there are some areas we need to regulate at the minimum level, like child protection or data privacy. We cannot leave every player as they please in the market. So, interestingly, I sit just between Linda and Marcus. It's the perfect seat. And also, I would say that, yes, we need some regulation, but we need to be very careful to find the best solution. And to do so, we need to communicate and cooperate. Okay?
We do.
Yes.
You benefit enormously from that relationship.
Yes. Linda and Marcus are very important customers. Yes, yeah.
I just like to say something about the portability of apps, just to shed a little bit of light on what goes on, for example, inside of a television company that runs a broadband software program. In order to push HBO Go out to the end user on tablet, telephone, or smart television, because the programming universes are so different, we actually have to sit down and specifically program apps for almost all of those devices. This is very time consuming, and guess what? I'm a content producer, and actually now an entire wing of my building has been consumed by people who are building apps and software because we are really trying to keep pace. Funny enough, working with Asia, in particular, Latin America, we still don't know. All of a sudden, there's a whole new universe of devices out there, depending on what market you're in. And the portability of apps among devices in the setting of more universal standards actually would relieve a lot of the financial pressure on us to do something that in reality is simply so far away from our core business, right? I'd rather take that money and put it into what's closest to my heart, which happens to be content, and programming devices is not content in my particular point of view. It might be for somebody else. So on behalf of content, I would support the idea.
Just before I pass the question, quickly, I heard as a consumer that when I can get the application, because it's what I understood now, it's because of those Apple Store, Android Store. Did you experience some difficulties there?
Talk a lot about net neutrality, and we agree on the fact that everybody has a different definition of the idea. We should maybe talk about the search neutrality, the OS neutrality, the application neutrality. At the end of the day, my question, and sorry about this, is more for you. We talk a lot about competition, the role of the competition authorities. Does this mean that the regulators are going to lose some power and going to merge with these competition authorities?
Thank you. Georg Serenci, Advisory Services. I'm getting back to the point Markus made rightfully about Facebook and WhatsApp. And I wonder why, if anybody can explain to me why this merger got unconditional clearance by the European Commission, and at the same time the Commission is extremely concerned and permanently counting the number of competitors per each and every European market. Is there any explanation who can give on that?
So again, Robert Pepper, Cisco. I can't believe that I'm hearing from this panel and from other people in the room that we should be regulating application development. When I was at the FCC, I used to joke that it was the Federal Communications Commission, and thank God it was not the Federal Computer Commission. If it had been the Federal Computer Commission, we would have had people coming in and saying, oh, you can't, to Intel, you can't go from a 1086 to a 286 or to a Pentium, because we still have apps running on the old chip. And if you did that, right, we couldn't operate, right? And, oh, you have to, you know, you have to make sure that everything is going to operate perfectly. I mean, I can't believe that, you know, Samsung would want a regulator, let alone a telecom regulator, telling you which version of Android you should be deploying on your tablets and your phones. I mean, how would that even work? I mean, yes, Linda, it would be a lot easier if the industry converged around a handful of these apps, right? Because it's a huge transaction cost for you. But I can't believe that you're arguing that some, you know, government regulator should be regulating and reviewing OS systems and the evolution of OS systems. That's the implication I'm taking away. It's shocking.
For us as a content producer, the number of systems out there is very challenging. I am not one to say what someone should regulate or not regulate, because I run a TV company, which is different. But the only point I would say is it's very expensive for us to do what we're doing. If there were more, I don't know. So there are two things happening for us, right? Programs are coming out that are more flexible and adaptable for various types of devices, right? That's a different way to tackle the same issue. And that's been very helpful for us. We just made an act for something called Activision, which can tackle a whole lot of older set-top boxes, right? Great. But until anything more uniform comes out of that, my only point was...
Where's HTML5? Does the HTML5 and that migration help you?
Yes. Yeah. And I wouldn't want anyone to tell anyone what to do, because I'm just not that kind of person. But I would only say for us, it can be really hard to program for all those things.
I'm very glad to hear your comment. I like your comment. What we are discussing here is not, we should be regulating the new technologies, but let's discuss whether we need new regulations beyond the current existing regulations, because this OTT and new technologies did not exist before when current regulations are founded. So that's the point. And for me, I wish we do not need new regulations. I'm on Windows side. But as I told you, Samsung is a very unique position. We communicate with all players in the market, so we understand the need to discuss. But the conclusion, I'm not sure whether we need new regulation or the current regulation is enough. It's up to you, up to market, up to the players and regulators.
And I think pretty much argue exactly the opposite of what you said.
I don't want apps development is regulated. I want that vertically integrated companies who have control over content, have control over search, have control over an application platform, keep new app developers out, keep Dailymotion out of the market. That's when we have to regulate. That's not new regulation. That is old classical competition law regulation. Yeah, that's what it is. Not new regulation. Competition law of dominance and deal with dominance and help small application providers, not hinder them from entering the market. And so quickly to Georg's question, I can't answer your question. I think the argument is that this is a highly dynamic market, and you know it's a digital world, and somebody new can come any day and knock off Facebook from its number one position. I don't think that's true anymore. That was true 3 or 4 years ago. We have passed the Rubicon here. It's not true anymore, but you know the Commission obviously sees that differently.
From our point of view, the only thing I can say is that in the current world, it's very possible that Jack, who would like to have all the HBO services on his handheld, now he's subscribed to a service provider. If we haven't built an app for it and we're out of money, you know, I spent my budget for this year, you know, he might have to wait because it's just not going to be there.
Just going back to Facebook WhatsApp, I mean, yes, the Commission cleared this acquisition last Friday. And I can just assure you that we gave quite careful consideration to that merger. We did a big, you know, market investigation, and ultimately the conclusion was that you know this they would not raise competition concern. I have maybe you know obviously there is a decision that will be published, and you know we may also do some articles about it. So I mean our reasoning will be you know more explained. You know, to the rest of the world. There were a few things, you know, that were mentioned in terms of, you know, some of the possible theories of harm that we examined. You know, WhatsApp today, I mean, what is a social network? I mean, clearly Facebook is a social network, is a very successful one. I mean, and some of the claims that we examine is WhatsApp today a social network? So, you know, we carried out an investigation, you know, quizzed many companies, not just telco companies, and, you know, opinions diverge as to what exactly. There is some common denominator between WhatsApp is exchanging, you know, messages, pictures, but you know, there's maybe a richer user experience, and you know, we found that WhatsApp today, you know, is not really a social network, or if it is, there are many other operators in this, you know, in this circle. In terms of barriers, you mentioned, I mean, this is a very different situation. I mean, these companies do not control the platform; they do not control, you know, the operating system. So, I mean, in terms of what barriers, you know, could there be for someone else to come in? And, you know, we didn't find many. The only thing was network effects, yes. We asked ourselves lots of questions about network effects. You mentioned 2 billion consumers together. I mean, you omit from that that there's already some overlap between the users of both. WhatsApp has 600 million users worldwide. Facebook is 1.2. And, you know, a lot, I mean, I forgot the exact numbers now, but 50 to 70% maybe are already Facebook users. then also to increase the network effects in terms of a communication service would mean linking the two services, because of course today I'm a WhatsApp user, doesn't mean that seamlessly I can start communicating with the other, you know, Facebook Messenger user that would not be today WhatsApp users. And that's not something that would happen overnight because of the way technically these services are structured. And I mean, we really went into a lot of this detail and, you know, found that ultimately, you know, we felt comfortable that, you know, this is not impeding competition on a specific market. But I mean, that's our best guess. I mean, we don't have a crystal ball. We just, you know, base it on facts and all the elements that we have from our market investigation and from the facts of the filing.
Tayfun Çatalıbe from Turkcell, Turkey. I want to make a point and then ask a question. I don't think being dominant is a crime or something by itself. Abuse of dominance is what's the problem. So that brings the question of how do we determine if there is abuse of dominance. And I think, and that's my question, where my question comes, do you think the current notions of determining or identifying dominance that we use in different markets, whether it's energy or telecommunications, networks, or others, are those notions enough or satisfactory to determine abuse of dominance in the new digital world? Because we are hearing from the European Commission, for example, that using the classical notions, they have cleared the merger, but we don't know what in the future such dominance would bring, because it's all about collection of data, and we all remember this summer's the Facebook mood study. I don't know I'm sure you must have heard of that, the study that Facebook did to see how they could manipulate the mood of the people. So what do we need? What kind of new notions do we need to determine dominance, the abuse of dominance?
Just in 30 seconds, because it's close to the coffee pause, in 30 seconds. Mr. Kim?
I think it's potentially not enough. It's a good point, actually. I think that competition law might not always be enough. First, you're absolutely right. It's the abuse of dominance, not the dominance itself. That's it. But I think I made this point with many examples where there is the potential of abuse of dominance by being vertically integrated and leaving others out. And I think that is the abuse. And, you know, this is not my view. I mean, look at how many investigations there are at European and national level. I'm sort of recounting what's going on here. But just to be brief on what alternatives are there, I think that interconnection is quite an interesting question, because interconnection in the telecoms world is not based on dominance. And we have very similar issues as we had in the early days of the telecoms world, where interconnection really broke down some of these barriers, some of these bottlenecks that we had. So I'm wondering if there isn't there shouldn't be an interconnect obligation which is detached from dominance in order to help smaller, for example, communications, over-the-top communication service provider, to enter the market and to create proper competition in the market. That's...
I think revising the current competition law or making new law is very... We must be very careful, because it's so influential to the industry. But also, at the same time, we need to pay very careful attention whether there's any abuse of dominance in IT industry under the current legislation, current regulation, or theory or logic or case. There might be we need to very pay attention whether they are complying with all the current regulations.
In addition, it's maybe your fault, Jack. The consumer is not on our side. The consumer doesn't care about abuse of dominance. The consumer still use Google in spite of Google pushing its own subsidiary in its ranking of results. The user doesn't care. I mean, he wants to have access to some content. doesn't care about the fact that YouTube is providing the same content that Dailymotion. If it's YouTube, it's okay for him. So one of the solutions will be a better awareness from on the consumer side of the fact that competition is key for the sake of the consumers.
Linda, do you want to add something? No? And just to wrap up, in 15 seconds, because as a consumer, I started to think that we could solve this afternoon. I think that we were missing someone today. Then maybe you have a message you would like to pass to the audience. What will be their job to do between now and the next session that they have to solve for you? Because I understood that there were some issues. In 50 seconds, 2-3 actions the audience should do. Giuseppe?
Regulators and competition authorities to better discuss together and to take a quick action. We talk a lot about the Google example. It lasts for more than 6 or 7 years with no real results. The market is dead now, and nothing happened on the authorities' side.
Parting words at the end of my presentation, but I would just say again, I think if you go forward and consider how huge the economy of scale is for OTT, just to consider the impact that that will have on the purely local content productions in your own markets.
I would like to ask you to choose the best product in the market. It will be your decision to make your future better. It's my comment.
I would say use a lot of OTT services. That is my advice to you. But be vigilant. Be careful that you don't sort of lose the choice that you could have in a competitive market.
To thank you, the whole panel, for the discussion. I think you still have a job because I understood there will be still things to at least to understand and to follow. And as a consumer, I understand that you will work for the best of me, of my choice, and so on. Thank you very much.